Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks so much for being here. I know that there's going to be people who are going to continue to be coming in, but we have a lot of ground to cover, so and a lot of great information for you all. Plus, we want to make sure that we have a chance to hear from you all as well. So we're going to get started. I just want to do a couple of housekeeping items. We have an evaluation that is going to be handed out towards the end of the panel. Please, please fill out the evaluation. Believe me, the NCLR team looks at those very closely to make sure that we build on the things that you found helpful, and we try to cut things or improve on the ones that you did not find so helpful. In addition to that, there is a mic in the middle of the room, which is kind of in a precarious position to get to. So when we get to the Q&A, since we're in a large room and so that other folks can hear you, if you can come up to the mic, and big prize if you don't knock off any of the two tripods that are on the way to it there. Or maybe we can try to move the mic a little bit behind. Anyway. Thank you so much. My name is Clarissa Martinez. I am with the Policy Department at the National Council of La Raza, and I have the privilege of being there as well, part of the civic engagement team. And we always have conversations about the Latino vote at our conference. It feels like this year is a hotter topic than in many other years. Not necessarily because this is, as some people often like to say, the most important election of your lives, but because it is, and it feels, a deeply personal election, given the tone of everything that's going on and how the Latino community is being presented. So indeed, deeply personal. A couple of the things we want to try to do today. You're going to hear some not yet released information from our colleagues at Nielsen, a report on the growth of the Latino population and its influence in a variety of aspects. You are going to, from Stacey Armas. You're gonna hear from Sylvia Manzano from Latino Decisions, who is the premier entity doing polling about Latinos, and we've been working with them for several years to give us a perspective on the mood of Latino voters and also some very nifty models they've created that you can play with. And then Martha Pardo with Latino Justice Pearl Dev is also going to talk to us about another very important element of voter participation, and that is that we know there's a lot of measures out there to suppress the vote, to make it harder for Americans to vote, and she's gonna talk to us about that and also bridge to the future, because as we know, campaigns may focus only on election day. For our communities, that's only one step along the journey. So we are going to talk a little bit about that, but obviously focus on this year since the election is upon us. So you've heard me introduce our speakers and you have their names as well. There are some materials. I just wanted to provide a couple of framing same page concept facts for you all as we delve deeper into this subject. And that is that by now it's a given that Latinos are a critical factor in the winning equation for the election. And there's a number of states, battleground states, where Latinos are going to be essential. But that list is actually growing. The other thing that is counterintuitive based on this knowledge that Latinos are essential is obviously the tone that we have heard on the campaign trail, rather than the more intense courtship, we've seen some outright antagonism from some. And then the other thing that is also counterintuitive is that although everybody's talking about the Latino vote, the investments that are being made in Latino efforts to do voter registration, to do voter engagement, have actually been shrinking. And we've talked to a number of organizations in the Latino space, and they are all feeling that. So again, something that is part of the struggle to make sure that our voices are heard is that we are also able to lead our own efforts to engage our community and not just have campaigns and candidates do those things when they need our vote. And then I always like to show this graph to people. We at NCLR have been using it now, I think, for about a decade, and we just keep updating it. And the reason this graph is important is because if you look at the very top line, which for 2012 represented 35.2 million people, that is the number of Latinos of voting age. The blue line underneath is those who are voting age and citizens. In 2012, that was 23.3 million. The red line is those who were registered, 13.7 million. And the green line is those who voted, 11.2 million. Now, why is this graph significant? Most people say Latinos don't vote. But in a presidential year, 80 to 82% of registered Latinos vote. So where the big opportunity and gap to close is between the number of Latinos who are not registered but are eligible and getting them registered, right? In midterm elections, the equation is a little different. But since we're in a presidential, I'm going to focus on that. Yet, here's the challenge. The vast, super vast majority of resources that is spent in an election cycle gets spent among the general electorate between those who are registered and those who vote, right? Getting the registered to vote, that's where all the money goes. And even at that, among Latinos who are highly frequent voters, they report under outreach from both political parties. So this kind of just gives you a good snapshot to walk away with. And right now, we have already about 12 million Latino citizens who are eligible to register but still need to do so. The projection is that we probably may see the Latino vote grow to 13 million in this election, which would be a growth of about 2 million from the previous one. Obviously, the potential is much greater. So with that, I want to pass the floor to Stacy, who is going to be telling us about some great information that Nielsen, again, it's brand new, it's not out yet, and bear with me, see if I can do this.
Thank you, Clarissa, and thank you, NCLR, and everyone for having us here today. I'm going to expand a bit on what she shared, and additionally give you some new information. Our role at Nielsen is to present the data, right? So while we have a lot of fun anecdotes and thoughts, I'm going to present some hard facts today that we can talk about and hopefully will inform us in the rest of the conversations that we have here. My name is Stacy de Armas, and at the bottom is my my Twitter handle. Feel free to find me there, message me, or reach out with additional questions. We have a report each year that we do, from our Diverse Intelligence series, and we're releasing one very shortly. I'm going to give you guys some highlights and previews of it today, just a few things that relate to this conversation so we can go right to the first page. As you've heard many times throughout this conference, and you will continue to, 50% of the total U.S. population growth from 2010 to last year has come from the Hispanic population. You know, and you've heard here many times, we are very strong. We are 57 million strong and represent 18% of the U.S. population, expected to reach 24% by 2040. And really, most of that growth all coming from us. So how are we growing, right? We've talked a bit about that during this conference, and I've heard it discussed as well. 78% of the increase in that population is actually coming from U.S. births. So those are Latinos that are born here. We are ambicultural. We keep our culture with us, and they influence and inform how we navigate our U.S. experience. But I think it's important to note that the growth is really coming, the majority, from U.S. births. So if we move to the next slide, here is why this is important, right? So we talk about eligible voters, and again, I just pulled a couple of slides that I thought would be important to discuss here, and I apologize in advance for math. I was told there would be no math, but I'm bringing it. So there are 27 million U.S. Hispanics who are or will be eligible to vote in this election. So that's 12% of the electorate. So I think one thing that we always hear, especially when you look at it in a pie chart like this, right? You look at the blue representing non-Hispanic white, the red representing Hispanics. You think, gosh, 12%, you know, of the overall, maybe it doesn't look that big. I think people sort of think that. But we're here to tell you, and it's why you're here, I'm sure, is because this piece is significantly important. And we're going to outline that in the next few slides, where we talk a little bit about the age distribution. Most importantly, so quickly, by way of comparison, so there's 3.4 million eligible Hispanic voters, or 14% of the total Hispanic population, will have come of age just since the last election, just since 2012. 6 million since 2008, 3.4 million just since 2012. But here's why this matters, right? And Clarissa set it up really nicely. If you look at the chart in the upper left, so you have your total population. Very simply put, 71% of your total population, of your total eligible population, is registered to vote. And of that, 62% voted. Okay? So it's pretty clear. Your white non-Hispanic, 74% of eligible voters registered. That's your blue. And your 64 is those that actually turned out. So if you look at these percentages, you're looking at about a 10% difference, right? Of your total population from 71 to 60, 9%. So of all of those that registered, which are the blue, about 10, you know, you're about 10, 9%, 8%, with the exception of African American, which is about 6%, of those that register actually vote. So an important point here when you look at Latinos, we're the same difference. We're 11%. We're right in there. So we show up. We turn up. So I think that's, first of all, we're talking about dispelling myths. When they say Latinos don't vote, we vote. We show up at the same degree as everybody else. We show up. We vote. When we are registered, we show up to the same degree as everyone else. The challenge here is the registration. 59%. Look at all the other groups hovering upward in the 70s. Only 59% of eligible Hispanics are registered to vote. Showing up at the same percent again, we show up. The challenge is registration, and I think my colleagues today will talk about all of the wonderful things that are being put into place to accelerate the registration. One of the things that we also talk about specifically here is, or I've heard discussed, is what are the sort of barriers? Why is that? Why is there a challenge to registration? What are the systems, the barriers that are set up either intentionally or non-intentionally that restrict Latinos from voting? Does it have to do with the day structure, right? You think about registering to vote and voting, those of us that have service industry jobs versus different types of jobs, how easy is it for us to just, you know, run out and take care of that, depending on your current socioeconomic status? So I think that's an important discussion to have, and the systems that can be put into place to aid with that. The bottom corner, which is sort of cut off a little, I apologize for that. This is a breakout of registration by age group, and the reason I thought this was important to talk about is, you know, we know we're significantly younger, but I think it's important to see that, you know, you have sort of the same spread within groups, but the majority of the eligible voters are young. We are, and actually if you go to the next slide, I think it's 61% of eligible Hispanic voters are 44 and under. And go to the next slide too, sorry, we're moving ahead quickly. So if you look at this chart, and I love this, I'm trying so hard to stay in my seat, guys. On the right-hand side, if you have 61% of eligible Hispanic voters that are under the age of 44, look at your white non-Hispanic. It's exactly converse. 61% are over the age of 45. So think about the differences in the issues, the opportunities, the structures around not only registering but voting. When you have the majority of your eligible voters under the age of 44 in one group and the majority over in another group, it's a complete, the issues to me in that group, just barely, guys, just barely, but I'm still under 44. The issues and the structures around my life are so very different than white non-Hispanic over 45. They have no idea my world, right? My kids, my soccer, what my lifestyle is like, the commitments that I've made. And so I think that's really important when you think about what my colleagues will talk about in terms of the opportunities, the challenges. And we can move forward. I'm just kind of buzzing through these. This is the same information, but by age and ethnicity. And I thought it was important, again, to look at, you know, I feel like when we look at these again, we think, oh, This has to do with not turning up. That's not the case. It's really a registration story. And I think that's why that has been so front and center and forward in the conversations we've been having around this election cycle. Next slide. And this I thought was just fun because we're all Latinas, so we were here. We're leading the way, ladies. Under the age of 64, we're really turning out to vote more than our male counterparts. So I encourage you to encourage the Latinos in your life, Latino men, to go and vote. When it comes to over the age of 65, however, definitely turning up. And if you think a lot about life experience, right, and you think about this story of sort of, what our community has been able to accomplish in half of a lifetime, right? I think even in my own personal experience with my grandfather and my father, and I look at what, their story in half of a lifetime, what they've been able to do for their family. Over 64, I think, in particular over 65, and this is a bit of an anecdote, has seen that through advocacy and involvement. Remember, they lived through different years, right? This is the, Cesar Chavez, years where that sort of work, however difficult it was, it did make a difference for their families, and they've seen that in their children and their children's children. I think that may have to do, and again, it's an anecdote, with why you see more voter turnout among Latino males over the age of 65. We can certainly talk a bit about that. And next slide, which I think may be my last one. Oh, so when we're talking, the reason I wanted to put this up is I thought it was important to take a look at how to reach Latinos. So we know where the issue is, or at least we think the issue we're going to talk about today is about registration. How we reach each of these groups based on their age is very important. So this is Nielsen data. And you can already see this in action. I know my colleagues are going to talk about apps that have been developed, websites, making it, in addition to there are paper campaigns too. There are traditional media and non-traditional, really reaching out to the communities the way they want to be touched and reached, the way that is comfortable for them so they can become registered and really close that gap, not only between registered and voting, but between registered and eligible. So that's it for me. We do have a report that is much more extensive. This is about 5 or 6 pages of what will be, around 60. Nielsen will be releasing it in just a few weeks. It is, everyone can download it. It's available online. It will be, you'll see some information if you follow me on Twitter or just kind of keep an eye. You will see when we release this in its full glory. We're very proud of it. And we're very proud of participating in this community and very proud to be here today. So thank you very much. Thank you for letting me set some stage with the data. I appreciate it.
Thank you. The other thing I wanted to mention in relation is that, the vast majority of Latinos are not just, almost half of the Latino electorate are millennials, right? And you've heard a little bit about that. But here's one thing to think about and why this registration gap that some people say, registering is so easy, right? Why people don't just do it? Well, one of the things to think about is with such a young population is that many of our voters, potential voters, stand to be first timers, right? And many of them at that also the first ones in their families. So it's not that they have a frame of reference or they're hearing from other folks. And as a matter of fact, one of the things that we constantly hear when we do our work in the community in different states, from when we started doing this work at NCLR in Iowa in 2002, and you go knock on somebody's door, people say, nobody had ever talked to me about voting. And to this day, you continue to hear that. So with that, I wanted to pivot a little bit more to the election environment and what we are seeing. And so I'm going to invite Sylvia Manzano to walk us through that.
Thanks, Clarissa. My name is Sylvia Manzano, and I'm at the research firm Latino Decisions. And I want to share a little bit of information about interest and enthusiasm among Latino voters in this election season. And then a couple of ways to think about how Latinos can influence this upcoming election in very concrete terms. So first, people ask us, are Latinos going to vote, right? That's the question. Are Latinos going to vote? And how do we know? What are the, unfortunately, as a pollster, I have no data on the future. but one of the best ways that we can get to that is, asking people about their level of enthusiasm, interest, how much they're engaged with what's going on now. So When we ask this question, you know, compared to the last presidential election, would you say that you're more enthusiastic now, or were you more enthusiastic in the last one? In 2012, at about this time, 37% said that they were more enthusiastic about that contest. In April, which is pretty far ahead of Election Day, and in April of this year, 48% said that they were more enthusiastic about voting this time compared to last time. And it's worth pointing out that in 2012, Latinos didn't say that we didn't hit 50% that said they were enthusiastic to vote until a week before the election. Mm-hmm. And so we're certainly on an accelerated trend here in terms of enthusiasm for turning out. And then thinking about how can you measure people's interest, in the last couple of surveys that we've done this month, 42% tell us that they themselves are talking about the election, and that could be talking literally, you know, the words coming out of your mouth. But we also incorporated your posting to Facebook, you're communicating on, you know, the comment section, but ways that people themselves are actively talking about or writing about, tweeting, sharing about the election. 42% said they're doing that now. 11% said they're doing that every day. And then another 31% said they're doing it several times a week. And then in terms of just following the election, right, a more passive way to measure keeping up with what's going on, 79% said that they're doing that, with about 38% saying every day, and then another 41% saying that they're keeping up several times a week. So it's a pretty engaged electorate. And then this past week, we did a poll of 1,200 Latino voters. We polled 300 every night of the Republican convention. And across that period, 72% said that they were following the Republican convention. There's a pretty high level of interest in what's going on, again, especially for this point in the campaign. From what we've looked at in previous years, we don't usually see this level of attention until much closer to Election Day. But there is a big gap between the level of interest, right, almost like unrequited interest, the level of interest among the Latino electorate versus the level of interest from campaigns, parties, and other organizations. When we asked people if they were asked to register or turn out or just, you know, talk about the election by any, you know, of those entities, in this month, 39% of Latino voters said yes, somebody had talked to them. At the 2014 midterm, we talked to people the week of the election, 41% had said yes, but that was up from 31% in the 2012 election. So that's certainly on the right trajectory, but as you can see, there's a pretty significant gap between, right, the 70-some percent that are paying attention, following every day, versus the ones who are going out and doing the work and making contact with the voters. How does this, you know, 12% of the electorate, how do they wind up having an impact on the overall, you know, on the presidency, you know, if it's such a small proportion? Well, the Latino population isn't distributed evenly across the country, right? We know that half of all Hispanics live in two states that are not competitive at all, Texas and California. But there are a handful of swing states, one of them that we're right smack in the middle of right now. There are a couple of swing states that have a relatively large Latino population, right? Florida, Colorado, and Nevada, where you've got more than 10% of all eligible voters, and then more than 15% of the people who actually show up and vote are Hispanic. But then you also have these other states that Clarissa alluded to at the outset, Virginia, North Carolina, Pennsylvania, where you've got only 3-5% of the eligible and voting electorate is Hispanic. But if the margin of victory is 3-5%, and this is the important caveat, and that voting group votes in a very cohesive fashion, then they can, right, turn an election, especially if there's other constituencies that they are voting with cohesively, whether that's other moderates or partisans or racial or ethnic groups or age cohorts, whatever you want to, however you want to, you know, sort of build that. So we have a couple of tools. This is one that we developed in 2012. And this is what the electoral map looks like this is how Obama won, where you have at the top, there's two sliders. One is what is the share of the Latino electorate, right, that actually votes? And then the other is what is the share that voted Republican? Actually, no, that's a simulation because it wasn't 23%. But if you move those sliders, if you go to the next slide. So if the Latino vote was at 42% Republican, right, like in George Bush's era, then they cross the 270 marker, right? Many more states, right, all those states are adjusted for the proportion of the population. But the idea is that even at 13%, if they're voting cohesively in one direction or the other, right, the other direction was what we just saw before, they absolutely can flip the election as a function of those very competitive states. And Florida is especially of interest because not only is it competitive, it also has a lot of electoral votes. Among the competitive states, Florida has the most electoral votes, which is why you see the most attention and spending and campaigning here. Another way to sort of take a look at what you might be able to project going forward is very straightforward without pictures. For those who are more numbers oriented. So what is the magic number? What share of Latinos have to vote for a Republican or a Democrat in order for that party to win? I have to say, we get more questions about Republicans from reporters than anybody else. Like, how can Romney win? How can Trump win? But especially, there's just tremendous interest in that share of the electorate. So that's how we have it designed. But the fact is, right, it's not just Latinos who will determine the election. It's also a function of what other groups in the electorate decide to do. So this is on our website, latinodecisions.com, 2016-calculator. And we started with a baseline that we slightly adjusted those. But if you look at, right, the proportion that voted for Romney, right, so what share of whites will make up the entire, of all voters this time? A generous assumption would be about 70.5%. It's probably going to be a little under that, but 70.5%. Romney got, I think, 57% of all, right, so among whites, what share will actually vote for Republicans? And then, of that, you have the total vote. Among Latinos, what share of the entire electorate? In the last election, they were 10%. So that's actually a very conservative estimate, saying that there's not going to be any increase. And among Latinos, what share vote Republican? Here we have a very, very generous estimate of 47%, which is 3 points higher than George W. Bush received, who hit the high water mark in
5 points.
In it seems so long ago, in 04. Black percentage, again, 12.5% with Republican vote at 12%, and then the other groups. And then if you go to our site, you can enter the numbers as you wish on the share of the electorate. If you believe there's sort of a theory out there that white turnout is going to spike. So if you think that white turnout is going to spike and a very large share of them are going to vote Republican, you can plug that in. If you think Latino turnout is also going to spike, you can plug that in. And then you can plug in the different estimates. And then at the bottom, the number will automatically compute the one in red. So in this estimate here, if whites are 70% of the electorate and Trump captures just under 60% of the vote, which is actually better than Romney did, right? If he does better than that and gets 47% of the Latino vote, seems unlikely. But there are other paths, right? Maybe he could max out on the black vote. There are a variety of ways you can run the estimation to look at what does it take for the candidate, you know, either party, however you want to estimate it, to win. So I'll stop there. Thanks, Clarissa.
Thank you. The reason I wanted Sylvia to talk about that modeling is because in some ways, right, we all read polls and statistics and different things, but it allows you to actually go in there and put in different numbers and see it for yourselves, which at least for me One is an opportunity to get your nerd on if you like polling and all that, which we do. But it also a way to it's a way to bring it home, like right in front of you, right? Depending on what the turnout rates from different people may be. So that's why I thought I wanted her to share that information so you can go and look at that. There's also information from one of the projects that we've embarked on together with Latino Decisions is a Latino Election Eve poll that we've done now from several cycles, and actually I think provides the most accurate information about how Latinos have voted in a number of different states. So you can access that through their website as well, and you might be able to find your state. Now, we haven't been able to afford doing it in all 50 states, but it's varied between 6 to 12 or so states there. Florida was one of the very interesting modeling ones that we did in 2012, where you can also see the breakdown of Latino performance by the different countries of origin that people are from for all the different states, for Florida, for the different issues, depending on party affiliation, et cetera. So very interesting information. So with that, I wanted to, again, pivot just a little bit. I think that you all have heard a fair amount over the last several years about the introduction of measures, in some cases administrative, in some cases legislatively, that in our opinion, and that frankly of many judges now, are measures that make it harder for eligible Americans to exercise their right to vote. And so I wanted to make sure that we touched on that, because as we are ramping up our efforts to make sure that our community, that we close those registration gaps that Stacey was talking about, that we also need to make sure we're giving people the information they need so when they show up at the polls, they're not turned away or denied a ballot or anything like that. And the reason all of these pieces are important, the growth of the influence of the Latino community, the role they play in different states, protecting the vote, is because at the end of the day, if our community grows stronger, we want to make sure that both parties feel compelled, obligated, required, you find your own word, to court our community intensely and passionately and to take actions that actually meet the expectations of Latino voters. So with that, I wanted to ask Martha what we should be on the lookout for and what's happening around the country.
Great, thank you for having me and for being here today. And as Clarissa mentioned, you know, now that everybody's registered and going out to the polls, we want to make sure that we know what to expect when we get there and what protections are in place. So overall, the Voting Rights Act was implemented about 50 years ago in order to make sure that minority voters have equal access to the voting process. You know, there's a number of protections. One of them that we look at in particular here in Florida, and we've actually partnered with some of our other organizations to help out with, is language access issues. Florida in particular, Section 203 of the Voting Rights Act, when you have about 10,000 language minorities or about 5% of the population, you can get designated after the decennial census as a language minority jurisdiction. We expect now they switched over to 5 years, so we're hope, I mean, in all optimism, we would love for that to come out before the election, but that might not be it, because it does offer protections for language minorities, in particular for our constituents, to have Spanish language materials when they go out to vote. So if anything that is available in English for those covered jurisdictions should be available in Spanish, from voter guides to ballots to advertisements, you know, anything that is really going to allow minority voters, especially language minority voters, to be able to have equal access to the voting places. So in Florida in particular, Florida as a whole is covered, so any state materials does have to be in Spanish. We've done a lot of work around this and in collaboration with election officials in the state to help upgrade and improve the quality of the materials that are out there. So while they may have been meeting their basic requirements for Spanish availability. It's also something that we want to make sure that our Spanish speakers can understand. Because as you all know, there's different variations in the Spanish language, but sometimes if they rely on, for example, their website to have like automatic translators, if anybody has ever experienced that, we know that they're not always accurate. So we kind of talk to them and make sure they've been very cooperative to help upgrade these materials and make sure that everybody is on the same page when it comes to voting. Florida also has 10 counties that are covered, meaning that those particular 10 counties do have to have Spanish language materials. So part of the work that we do is to make sure, not just during election time, but throughout the time when maybe election officials are not as busy, where we can go and talk to them and have a dialogue. And you know, usually that works. And if it doesn't, then we have to resort to other measures. But to make sure that the materials are available so when Spanish-speaking voters go to the polls, they know that those materials will be available to them. There's also a very different protection under the Voting Rights Act, in particular for Puerto Rican voters that have been educated under American flag schools, but the primary language is in Spanish. So this is particularly important for those jurisdictions that may not be covered under Section 203, but have been seeing an increase in Puerto Rican populations. Because as you may know, we do have a large influx of Puerto Ricans moving off the island due to the economic crisis. And so that allows for Puerto Rican voters that maybe don't speak English well to be able to go and access those materials. So we are looking at this issue in Georgia because there is a large number of Puerto Ricans that have migrated there. And so we're still, you know, monitoring that very carefully to make sure that our voters can get out there and vote and understand the process in the meantime. There's also another protection under the VRA, which is Section 208, which allows for this applies for disabled voters, but it also extends to language access voters. So this allows for a voter to take an assister of their choice into the polling site to help them translate the ballot if, in fact, that particular section does not have Spanish language materials. And so as long as there are certain restrictions, they cannot be your employer or a union representative, but for the most part, you know, we see this a lot in our communities where we may have a family member that can help us in, you know, translating. And so this is very beneficial for those voters that may not have or may not live in a jurisdiction that is necessarily covered. So those are some of the protections that still are in place. Unfortunately, in 2013, the US Supreme Court struck down a very key provision in the Voting Rights Act that did not require preclearance for certain changes in the election cycle or in election procedures. Before in those jurisdictions that were traditionally engaged in discriminatory practices. And this will be the first presidential election without those full VRA protections. So we are, you know, very much on alert to make sure that our communities can go out and exercise their right to vote without any barriers. Unfortunately, as Clarissa, you know, originally mentioned, there have been barriers that have been popping up since this decision came out 2 years ago, 3 years ago. And those are things that we watch for. I mean, nationwide, there has been a surge in voter ID laws, like in North Carolina. I mean, we had a good decision now in Texas where, you know, they found that the voter ID law there was discriminatory. So at least, you know, that's a positive amidst, you know, all the downside that has been going on. So we're very mindful of these kinds of laws that have been surging and making sure that our voters can get out there and vote. So on that note, part of our project for this upcoming cycle, we hope to start this during the primaries here in Florida, but definitely during the general elections, we will be having our Cada Voto Cuenta program, where we will be having volunteers. Our goal is to recruit 180 volunteers nationwide in key places where we know that the Latino vote is extremely important and may encounter difficulties. So two of our efforts here in Florida are in Central Florida and in South Florida. We're going to have efforts in New York, in North Carolina, Pennsylvania, and Georgia. So we are actually, I have some flyers on the table because we're looking for legal and grassroots volunteers to help in certain jurisdictions to make sure that we can monitor polls in specific places where we know that that there's a large number of Latino voters that may encounter some difficulties. And some of those are, you know, are you getting the right ballot? Are you being told that you are not registered when you know that you did it within the deadline? Are there polling place locations that have been shut down without any advance notice? Are there really long lines at the polling places, which are always a flag for our monitors that are on the ground, because that could be an indication of some discriminatory practice. Is there police presence or is there voter intimidation? And some of these things could be very subtle. Sometimes they're very overt, but it's important to be mindful. So we're really excited about this project. It's part of the national affiliation with the Election Protection Program. And we're really hoping to get as many volunteers on the ground to make sure that every vote does count. Because, I mean, we can get really technical, but won't do that today. But we want to make sure that, you know, our voters, when they're out there, they know that you know, they're doing the right thing and that the election officials are not trying to, you know, pull a fast one on our voters. So that's our effort, and we're hoping to have volunteers on the ground also during early voting. Florida does have early voting, so we're hoping to have that in particular because we know that a lot of our folks take advantage of early voting, so and it becomes very convenient, and so we want to make sure that it's not just to focus on election day, but also throughout the election period. And then, you know, segue into the future, our Latino population continues to grow as all the data shows, and we just have to be very mindful that, you know, that we can essentially become a population, as we have become already, that can really impact and have change. And so with that comes some challenges, as always, and there's always forces that will try to undermine that. But, you know, especially for 2020, there will be redistricting cycles, and so we want to make sure that those efforts are done correctly and that they are not being done discriminatorily, and that, you know, that every vote eventually does count, because that is important. And so we will see, we are being very mindful, you know, during the redistricting process coming up in 2020, to make sure that the lines are drawn the right way to account for the population growth. You know, in particular, here to use Florida as an example, back when in 2010, when the lines were redrawn for the congressional districts, due to the particularly Latino growth in Florida, we picked up two additional congressional districts. And so, you know, that's just probably the beginning. We continue to have a large influx of Latinos moving to our state, so we anticipate that just to increment. And so we have to be very mindful. We're ready for litigation if need be, and just getting involved in the process early on, whether it's through coalitions or committees, and really getting involved with local officials to make sure that we're watchful as those lines are drawn.
And that is one of the reasons, going back to the beginning, right, as we were saying, that it's important. As Stacey mentioned, we are showing up, and that is particularly true in presidentials. I think in midterms is one time when many Latinos who are registered do stay home. And so the challenge in midterms is to make sure that, you know, we get that 80 to 82% of Latinos who are registered, if not better, to do the same they do in presidentials in the midterm cycles. And one of the reasons why that is important is because it's normally those years where a lot of state legislature makeup is decided, and a lot of those bodies are the ones that have say over redistricting. And redistricting should not be a partisan issue. In fact, in different states, there's been fights with both parties about redistricting lines because political parties ultimately want to preserve their incumbents, whether they be good representatives to our community or not. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so that's why it's important for our community to be present and to vote all the way down the ticket, right? Because it is those state legislators who are gonna make those decisions. And frankly, it is those city council people who have an impact on our lives daily. So that is part of the message that we have going forward.
And I wanted to add, I think what you were saying, Marta, was so important about, you know, you talked for a second about language. And I quickly, you know, went to this additional page of data that I haven't shared, you know, yet. And I was looking at intent to vote by language dominance. And I was thinking about why for Spanish language dominant, it's you know, very different, for example, than total Hispanic, English language dominant, or bilingual. And I think a lot of that, you know, and this is among eligible. So we're not talking about, you know, any other issues there than potentially access to information or potential barriers. And so I think that is a really important thing. And in particular, when we talk about midterms too, these are, you know, potentially for presidential elections, a lot of that happens. I mean, that's just par for the course. You have materials translated and there's efforts in many languages. But for midterms, that isn't always. And so if we're bringing people to, you know, it's almost sort of like taking people down a path, right? There is no reason that those same efforts shouldn't be put into place for midterms to encourage and have really it become part of the culture of being an American or being being a citizen here, and then having that then shift, you know, moving forward. Looking specifically at Spanish language dominant Hispanics, you know, a full 34% say that they are not registered, and another 40% are unsure. And so I think a lot of that has to do with what, you know, access, potential barriers or blocks, or how systems are put into place to ensure, like we do with every other community of color, to ensure that those are easily, you know, sort of surmountable.
And because we, you know, we at NCLR want to make sure that we don't just talk about things people should do, but that we figure out how to get those things done and get to the how, right? And I, just like our voters, I think in every election cycle, the big question about when candidates talk about the issues is like, okay, how?
Right.
So for us, the same way, we want to make sure that as we structure our campaigns to promote voter engagement as part of a more holistic vision, frankly, about what civic engagement means. Again, for us voters, the election is a step on a journey. It's not the end of the road. But where it comes to elections in particular, that we're focusing on creating tools that are gonna make it easier both for the individual and for our partners, since NCLR is a network of community-based organizations across the nation, to engage our communities. Because the reality is that most of you are not in the business of doing that every day. Some of you are running schools to educate our kids, or healthcare clinics, or workforce development centers. And so what are some ways in order to do that? And what we've been doing over the years is try to look at proven methods and also try to bring in some innovations. Again, because as you were saying, right, there's different people with different sensibilities, and some of them like it online or in person. And so we are mixing those things up. I'm sure if you've been at the expo, you've seen our canvassers here from the local Orlando community where we've been working now for several years, who are doing voter registration. In addition to that, we obviously are trying to pull ourselves into the future as well. And that is to bring technology into this arena. So one of the things that we did, even though you wouldn't necessarily think of NCLR in that way, was we were the first Latino organization in partnership with Me Too that developed a voter registration app. So the idea is we're gonna be in the community, on the streets, we're gonna be online, And the other thing we do is let's try to be in schools, which is where a lot of our young people, before they go to college or to work or to start families, we can go there. So this year, our civic engagement team partnered with schools in our network, working with administrators, with students and faculty, to develop curriculum that high schools can use that include voter registration. Because it's not enough to tell people, do this. It's good to give them the tools how. So teachers now have a ready-made curriculum they can use with lesson plans and sample exercises and everything, including some of the materials that you are seeing there on your chairs. And so I want to make sure that we share those tools with you because I think, as you've heard from all the presentations, it's going to take a lot of different interventions from all of us to be able to close those gaps. With the app, we are hoping that it empowers the individual, right? It puts voter registration in the palm of your hand. And not only that, the most exciting thing to me is now if you have this app on your phone and, you know, you're having lunch with friends or with your mom and they happen not to be registered, you can just open the app, hand them the phone, and have them register, right? And we're going to follow up on the back end to make sure that, you know, everything goes through smoothly and get in touch with people who may not complete the process. You can join us also every month. We talked about there's 12 million Latinos who are citizens who are not registered. And every year, an average of 1 million Latino citizens turn 18. So what we're trying to do is, in recognition of that, on the 18th of every month, with the folks in our network, do a push to remind people, hey, there's an app, or if you're in these locations, you can go to these communities, to organizations to get registered, so that we just keep refreshing that. We are going to be doing in September a big back-to-school voter registration push using the High School Democracy Project curriculum. We're going to be working with the schools in our network, as well as our affiliates with the schools they have relationships with, to do that again. Well, we have still a month to go before the deadlines. And because there's a lot of information out there, good information, we're also going to create a central location at NCLR where you can find a number of things, including a bilingual hotline that's been operated by our sister organization, NCLR, for many years, where people, you know, again, different strokes for different folks. Some people may want to look it up online. Sometimes I just want to talk to a person, right? And this actually will connect them to a real person they can ask questions about. So again, I think the spirit is tools that we can use. And we didn't really get into that, but at the end of the day, we want all candidates to be courting our voters, and the message to them is that candidates matter, positions matter, and meaningful outreach is essential. And there's not a lot of outreach to our community right now. Last but not least, as we were saying, the electoral participation is part of a continuum. What we all want is transformational policy change for our community. And that means that, you know, we move on to other work after the election. So with that, and the message that we need to move forward together, particularly in these times, I want to make sure that before I open it up, I also recognize Stacy and Nielsen, not only for the work that they're doing and the report that you're going to be putting out with great information, but also for sponsoring this session. As you know, it's very important to be able to bring this information to you, to have the support partners working with the Latino community. With that, I want to make sure that we open it up for your questions, comments, or suggestions. And as Martha mentioned, if you see something, say something, particularly right now with the State of the Voting Rights Act, hearing from folks on the ground what is happening so it doesn't go under the radar is extremely important. And we'll provide our Twitter handles or other things you can contact us. I still have to remind myself to do that when I saw you do that. But last but not least, before we go to the mics, I just wanted to recognize a couple of my colleagues from the NCLR Civic Engagement Team who are really the engines behind our work. And there's Janet Hernandez over there in the back. Janet was the co-author working with our education team of the high school democracy curriculum. So amazing work. And then Allison Osorio over here in the back. Stand up, Allison. Who's working also as part of our Latino Vote Fellows, folks who in their communities are organizing events to promote participation. So definitely big recognition to them and the rest of the NCLR team here from Communications and Policy. So with that, do we have any questions or comments? Not a problem. Okay, so the great thing is we've introduced Janet. Anybody who's interested in taking a look at the curriculum before you hear from us, because there's going to be a push as soon as the dust settles from conference, but make sure that you come to see her and give her your card so that she can send you the copy of the curriculum. We're also working with the American Federation of Teachers to see if it can be put in there. Share My Lesson platform where teachers go to get lessons.
If they don't use a mic, can you repeat the question for people online to know what the question is?
Absolutely. Thank you for that. No problem. The question was about folks who are interested in using the High School Democracy Project curriculum, which includes voter registration tools and exercises for teachers to use in the classroom. And in order to access that, you can send an email to hsdemocracyproject@nclr.org. Those folks in the room can contact Janet Hernandez in person. Great. Sure, that'd be great.
So thank you so much. This was fascinating. And what I particularly found fascinating was this big discrepancy between voter registration among Latinos. And I was wondering if you had any insight into why that happens. You guys mentioned outreach, but anything else? And also, what are the messages that work to try to get Latinos to register to vote? How do we connect with them?
Great question. You want to talk about that?
Well, I certainly can only speculate, but I think what we did talk a bit about today, and this I would leave for an organization to speak more specifically to, would be about, again, sort of structures or barriers that are in place. We talked about language potentially and materials. But I too, as I was looking at this, I was like, everybody's everyone's in the 70%. Why are Latino registration numbers so much lower? And what led me to that was this discussion with Latinos don't vote. We don't show up to vote. And then I was looking, that's not true. We actually do show up. The difference was in registration. So, from a Nielsen's perspective, we present the data. We can certainly speculate, but it is quite obvious that there is a discrepancy. What has led to that? I will let my colleagues address.
There's a few things that we know for sure. Half of the Latino electorate lives in non-competitive states, in Texas and California, right? They're like evil twins. No matter which side you're on, right? Either you think the red side's evil or the blue side's evil, right? They're diverse, they're border states, and they're completely lopsided politically. So 50% live in those two states alone. Campaigns don't invest that much in voter reg.
That's right.
Right? It is very, very expensive, as y'all know. I just revealed which evil state I'm from because I just said y'all. So it's much more expensive to register a voter than to remind somebody who's already on your side. So there's that. So half of them are in those two states. But then you add New York, New Jersey, Illinois, and you've got 65% of the electorate in states that are not competitive at all. So that's a big part of it. Then there's these other two. So the realities of our demography have a lot to do with it. So it's not competitive. And then, as was pointed out, a large swath of these unregistered are under 25. And that's an even more expensive group to register, in part because they have higher residential mobility, right? Mm-hmm. So if you are 30 years old right now, how many times have you moved in the last 10 years? Probably a couple. So if I'm going to register you, is it worth my money if I'm going to have to keep trying to find you every 2 to 4 years? And part of why you see higher turnout among older voters is that it's habit, but they also get reminded, right? My parents had the same address for, you know, a lot, right? You're like, oh yeah, my parents, right? There's not as much mobility. It's much easier to do contact. So registration on younger is more expensive, and then registration among younger in non-competitive states is not a priority.
That's a good point. And I was looking at the registration data here among California and Texas. And interestingly enough, there are registration is about the same, right, for California and Texas among Latino voters. But the turnout is 10 percentage points lower in Texas. Mm-hmm. And there are, you know, a lot of reasons that, of course, we can speculate on. I think what you said was really important, though, about age, in addition to mobility for the younger group. The other thing I would say is also lifestyle. And I know I keep bringing that up a lot, and that's a lot of what we do at Nielsen, is not only quantitative but qualitative data, too. And I think lifestyle and behaviors when you are in a younger group don't always permit you the same sorts of time and flexibility as when you're older, in terms of, you know, meeting the qualifications or the deadlines, or that, you know, there are your lifestyle is quite different. So it doesn't mean that you can't do it. It means that we need to think through that as those who want to ensure that this process happens and make it improve access, which I think NCLR has done an amazing job with this app and making the access so available that you can be, as you said, across from lunch with your sister and say, what? Here, you know, let's do this. So I think that's really fascinating, and I've seen a lot of that lately, and I think it's going to definitely turn a lot of this around. Interestingly enough, Illinois, the same. Voter registration looks right on par with Texas and California, but turnout significantly lower there. So we think about the age, you know, potentially also the age of Latinos in those areas and how that might impact it.
So there's the environment, right? When there's a buzz, when there's excitement, people are going to be more interested. The other thing, frankly, and this is one of the things that is dangerous. On the one hand, I would implore to all of us that we strip from our language this reference that we are apathetic.
Absolutely not.
And this is the reason, right? I hear it all the time. I hear it every election year. I strongly believe that Latino voters are not apathetic. We are unconvinced. The parties, the candidates need to come and court us or whatever it is. But the reality is that many folks in our community also feel, and we're not alone, that elections come and go and things don't change, so what's the point? Right? I mean, we encountered this quite a bit. It's not that people are apathetic. They are working like hell out there. And they're engaged in their church and in other things. But I think the case that I try to make to folks is that, you know, you didn't get your diploma the first day you registered to go to school. You had to stay in school and complete your courses and your requirements and go through the whole thing, and then you got your diploma. And voting is a little bit like that, right? It's an investment that you make day in and day out. And what we've also found that works is that, and this is true in so many ways for Latinos, that it is about community and about family. A lot of the messaging on voting is about, you know, what is your individual gain going to be? And what we've noticed in polling as well is that in previous elections, when asking Latinos if they were more coming out to vote in support for the candidate of their choice or to take a stand for their community, at least a plurality, in some places it was a majority of Latinos who said it wasn't the candidates that were moving them, it was about their community and family, and that is very powerful. We have a question.
Thank you for presenting today. So I'm seeing statistics and I've been hearing a lot about the importance of the Latino vote, then I think about one particular candidate who has made it, I would think, a challenge to attract the Latino vote. Now, I'm trying to understand, based on the statistics you shared, that it sounds like it would be pretty impossible to win without that support. So I'm trying to figure out, what does he know that we don't know about his ability to win? Is there something else that perhaps you can share about how that would work for him to be successful without the Latino vote?
There's nothing he knows that's that's a secret about Latino voters and their preferences. We did a poll this past week during the Republican convention, and we tested a lot of things that Republicans have said. And we gave people quotes, and we said, Donald Trump has said, I love the Hispanics. Trump loves Latinos, and Latinos love me. And then we asked, do you love Donald Trump? And we have data on that now. 88% of Latino voters do not love Donald Trump. If someone asserts that you love them, wouldn't you like to say if that's true or not? Right? Remember when you're a little kid, like, I don't like you. Why are you saying that I like you? He has set a high bar. And I showed, like, there's other groups as well. So, of course, right, the Latino electorate is not at all being courted. In fact, they're being repelled, right? It's very clear when a sign says keep out. And at some point, people say, "Oh, I'm not welcome here. You don't want my vote. I'm not interested. You're not interested in me." So, it's a very different tone, as someone has said earlier. But it's not just Latinos who have been getting those kinds of messages, right? There's lots of other groups that have been singled out in other ways. Latinos probably get more coverage because I think, you know, there's certainly been more talk and focus. But he has set a very high obstacle for himself by making it harder for people to listen to not just him, but what the party stands for or to other candidates down ballot. Sure.
Did you have anything on this? Here's what all candidates know, right? At the end of the day, it's a numbers game. And people are going to try to get more folks who are on their side out as opposed to the other side. In a lot of political campaigns these days, the reason why people use negative campaigning is not necessarily because it increases the number of people who vote, but it's because it decreases the number of people who vote. And so campaigns are either trying to increase the number of people who are going to vote for them and or decrease the number of people who are going to vote for their opponent. Both sides do this, right? And so right now, I think that there might be some folks who feel that by intensifying the support and the energy on their side, they could potentially overcome challenges that might have been created by their rhetoric, right? And I think both sides are looking at different combinations of that. It's this calibration of, if I say this, how many do I lose? How many do I win? Both campaigns do that. And so I think that it's not that there's something he knows that we don't, is that that's the game they're playing and hoping that they'll be able to mobilize more people, even in spite of the ones that they're antagonizing.
But I would say just real quick, one can overplay your hand on that. Assuming that for every hostile thing I say about Muslims, about Latinos, that all the whites are going to get excited about that is an incorrect calculation, right? We've seen that play out in California where Republicans lost not just Hispanic votes, but they lost white votes too, right? It's not just that most Latinos are really uncomfortable with that rhetoric, but there's lots of people of different backgrounds who are uncomfortable with, you know, the comments about Muslims, about African Americans, about women. The idea that it's a zero-sum game, that I gain white votes or white male votes every time I do this, is an incorrect calculation. The other idea that you can run up the white male vote enough to win makes the assumption that, again, they're evenly distributed. Because if you run up the white male vote in Texas, Tennessee, and Alabama, you've gained no traction in the Electoral College.
That's true.
Right? So there's a couple of things I think might be like simplistic ways of thinking about, you know, what are the what's the demography that gets him there? But if you dig a little deeper, it still gets really, really tricky.
Yeah, thank you so much. I really appreciate this presentation. It's been great. My question sort of has to deal with, the midterms coming up. And, you know, what NCLR is sort of doing around kind of an integrated voter engagement kind of program to turn out the Latino vote over the course of the midterms and beyond. And sort of how that's been, you know, successful for you guys in the past and you know, what your sort of general thoughts on building a program for like a longer term turnout strategy.
Well, as I mentioned at the beginning, and this has also been experienced by organizations in our network that are active in the civic engagement space, whether it is from a litigation perspective or an on-the-ground perspective, is that the investments in voter registration and civic engagement are shrinking, particularly the ones that are Latino-led efforts. I think that right now there is a lot of money flowing out there. But I think that there is a lack of understanding about just the level of expertise, cultural competence, and know-how that is available in the Latino community. And in some ways, we tend to be seen more as lab rats than as lab partners. But because of that, right, we're not just sitting idly by. And that's one of the reasons that we're looking at different methods to try to do this work, whether it is with technology, which we have to test. We're not just going to say that's the silver bullet. Working with schools. And also, frankly, the other interesting thing is that the majority of Latinos still tend to register through government agencies, and in particular, through the DMV. And so really promoting those things. And one of the reasons that hasn't happened like full strength is because one of the pernicious things about the way that voter registration work is happening is that if you can't count it and make a copy of it and present it to funders, it doesn't count. So some things that are big opportunities, like the DMV and other places, are not used because people can't count that. Or like in this case, right, working with schools so they register kids. But since the gap is so big and what we're interested is in closing it, we are exploring those tools. And our work also, you know, between elections shifts through issue campaigns, because obviously that's what people really are energized about, and then back on to electoral in the midterms, where we've been doing that work. But again, you face these challenges. So trying to get creative about tools people can use is important. And because we've been talking about funding, and not to put her on the spot, but it is important to recognize folks who, as that the funding evaporates, particularly among Latino organizations in the Latino community, to recognize those who, through thick and thin, have stayed the course and made the case to other people to do that. So I want to recognize Jerry Mannion with the Carnegie Foundation, the Carnegie Corporation of New York, and also a partner in Four Freedoms Fund, because those folks have been there not only with support, but with training for organizations to learn the ropes and to get better at doing this work.
Hola, thank you. The beautiful presentation. I'm so excited to be here. I'm Marisela Gutierrez. I'm the CEO of an organization called Siren. We do immigrant rights organizing in the Silicon Valley area. And we're mobilizing the immigrant vote. So we launched a robust campaign called Vota Hoy para cambiar el mañana, Vote Today to Change Tomorrow, where we're targeting potential immigrant voters and getting people, you know, naturalized. And we also have a curriculum that we launched in school, so I would love to check out your curriculum. We're targeting community colleges and high schools. Our main challenge right now is really getting the millennial vote, as you talked about, the younger vote. What do you think are the key issues that will bring the millennial vote out to vote? That's something that we would love to learn about, you know, nationwide that's going on, that will get them out of their chairs or off their phones to show up to vote.
Do you guys have? I don't want to.
Well, I mean, we've done, whenever we do polling, you know, we break them out by age groups. And, you know, among millennials, the issues that they identify as most important probably wouldn't surprise you. In immigration, jobs, and education are usually in the top three. And immigration can mean a couple of things. It can mean, you know, about the status for their parents or a relative. Or it could just be about the tenor of politics and how it is now. Education, a lot of times, you know, people will tell us more specifically about being able to pay for school or being able to, right, just finish. You know, how do I go to school and I have other obligations? Even if school was paid for, I still need to work because I contribute to my, you know, family household income. So these plans that people have about, you know, less expensive college or free college isn't necessarily going to change their 24 hours in a day. And you know, very aspirant community, that age cohort, you know, college is a among their, you know, top life goals. And then, right, jobs, you know, those two go hand in hand. So I think that, you know, meeting them where they're at on their phones is is pretty important. We also know that with respect to, you know, talking to Latino voters and younger, this is true as well, that, you know, when Clarissa was talking about cultural competence, you know, message testing that comes from a think tank in DC might not really work with immigrant voters in Silicon Valley or, you know, third generation, you know, Mexican Americans in Arizona, right? That talking to people about what's happening in their community and saying, you know, your neighbors voted, you should vote or else I'm going to tell on you. Maybe that doesn't really resonate, right? I mean, that seems to be like a really popular thing in the GOTV. Is like, oh, tell them we're going to rat you out. Like, oh,
that doesn't work.
The government's going to come for you is like one of the most, just cringeworthy sorts of things. And so what resonates in somebody else's research and data, and I love data, but might not always work in other circumstances for other groups, age cohorts. So if you're in the Silicon Valley, like, you have the best people to ask, and those, you know, the people that are around you, and once you have a few people that you're already that go through it, ask them, like, what did we do right?
And I think I would also think about a lifestyle, you know, life cycle curves, which is sort of a big term. But as I'm looking again at this data, you know, a full 20% of eligible voters are Latino eligible voters are between 18 and 24, and another 41% 25 to 44. So we talked about 61%, remember, being under the age of 44. I know specifically you're talking about millennials, probably more the 18 to 20 year olds, but still a full 20%, which is more than any other ethnic group of us Latinos that fall in that young group. So and then so that's the first thing you look at. Then I would take a look at this life cycle curve, and you think about non-Hispanic white and Hispanics that are of the same age, okay? So so as an example, I think about, you know, my parents. And the, you know, Latinos as a community, we are younger, and we have children younger, we have families younger. So generally, we're at different life cycle points in that curve than our non-Hispanic white counterparts. So I'm gonna get there, just come down this road with me, guys. So what my example is, I think of my parents in their you know, very early 60s, who have friends their age, non-Hispanic white friends, whose children are just coming out of college, you know, whose children are in their early 20s, and even those experiences, you know, they're on par in age. Their experiences, where they're at, is completely different, right? My parents have two kids in their 40s, and they have four grandchildren. And yet their non-Hispanic white counterparts are like, in a whole, you know, they have millennials coming back to live at home with a whole different life cycle. So when you think about, I think what's more important is not just looking at the age necessarily, but really taking a look at what constitutes our community. The issues that are of importance to my parents are very different than the issues that are of importance to their counterparts. Now, they're not the age group we're looking at, but if we look at 18 to 24-year-olds, and we know that we are a... you know, I guess for lack of a better term, sort of a communal culture. The issues for 18 to 24-year-olds, and really even 25 to 34-year-old Latinos, are very different than those of their counterparts. By that, when I was in that group, 25 to 34, I already had two kids. My family was starting. That's how my, you know, that, and that is somewhat cultural, but that was also, those are my choices. But I would say that within that group, there are very different issues and things that are of importance to your non-Hispanic white counterpart. So things like education, which you talked a lot about, immigration, these are issues that we have seen also through our data that rise, and maybe not for the same reasons. You very, you know, well said, you know, potentially for our parents, but there are other family issues and items that have a different level of importance. So I guess the point is looking really at each group very specifically and specific to your region as well to understand what are the things that are going to bring those adults out to register and then to take the step and actually vote.
And what I would add to that is that, you know, so when we developed the high school curriculum, we didn't get our civic engagement team and our education development team to work on it in a vacuum. Like I said, they met with school administrators because obviously you need to get their blessing, mm-hmm. right? They met with teachers because teachers are the ones that would implement the curriculum. Is this usable? Is this, you know, useful to you at all? But we also met with students to make sure that the material was something that they would find interesting. So to me, the most important thing when we're trying to figure out what makes someone tick is to talk to the person we're trying to make tick, right? And so I would talk to those students directly. What I see and what we know is that people are engaged, right? They are participating in their community. And again, sometimes we look at voting in a very cynical way because we don't see immediate results. And you know, there the thing I would say is we may not be guaranteed the outcome we want in one occasion, but we are guaranteed to not get what we want if we don't participate. And so, you know, you just gotta build it little by little.
And registration is up so much. I think we've talked a lot about that. I wanna just add that point before we finish. We have a California organization that just we pulled some data from. And for them, for that one group alone, 98% increase in voter registration from the same time, you know, just 4 years ago. So, and that, well, that's not our doing, but that's one thing that was reported. And so I think we're talking a lot about that, but this is happening. We've seen increases also in Texas and in Florida. And in Illinois, there are spikes in registration. So a lot of these things, the efforts are working. I think we don't want to rest at all on that. We want to continue to push and drive and ensure that we are well represented and we know that we show up already. I think we've established that, right? But that we are very well represented.
So we're going to take the last question, but before we do that, if I can make sure that the evaluations have been passed out, and please don't forget to turn them in. So don't leave yet. We're not done. We have one more question, and then we'll have some final comments. Go ahead.
All right. My question is this. I don't know what's in your curriculum, but I recently talked to two millenniums who were both excited about Bernie. One Latino, one not. And they both were kind of like, well, what the hell's the point? We're not going to vote now. And so I said, guys, you know about the Supreme Court. And I got to tell you, both of these kids are in college. And they kind of looked at me with glazed eyes. And I said, the important thing is not who's the president for the sitting in what you think they're going to do, but we're going to be naming justices of the Supreme Court. And these are kids who care deeply about inequities and injustices, both of them. And so I said, so who sits on that court actually makes decisions that affect not just you, but your grandkids all the way down for the huge long time. And so I threw one thing out. I don't remember if it was Brown versus, but whatever. So I'm hoping that your curriculum does some of that because civics is not being taught in schools. Our kids do not really know this. I mean, I'm in Florida, so maybe it isn't somewhere else. But I hope that was part of the curriculum. And I have asked, and everybody thinks I'm joking, we need a 140-character tweet that explains that business about the Supreme Court. Okay? So, Clarissa, can you make that happen?
I can come up with the tweet, and we'll definitely make sure if it's not already in there that the role of judges is in the curriculum. Did you want to add anything on that point?
Yeah, I mean, I do think it is important, like you said, you know, for civic education, because a lot of people don't know what the process is and what that impact is. And as you had touched earlier, even the role of our local officials and our local elections and how that truly impacts our daily life. And so I think that we all get excited during presidential elections, and that's what we know. But I also think that it is important to give that, you know, that spotlight to the local elections mm-hmm. that really affect, you know, how our schools are operated, you know, how our local funds are allocated, because that is truly important. And I think that we all take it for granted. But that I think that's just maybe a collaborative effort to educate voters a little bit more. And, you know, I don't have the answer to that, but I do think it is important to kind of touch on that.
I know we're wrapping up, but I want to add one mm-hmm. tiny 30 seconds to that, because she brought up a good point that in California, registration is automatic. So I think if you and I was talking specifically about Hispanic registration, but that's a fantastic point. And I don't want to let that go on this conversation, because you think about engagement and, you know, how much more. And now I want to go back and look at the data. What's the level of difference in engagement when someone actively makes that choice to register to vote
exactly.
versus when it's just sort of automatic and there was, you know, no sort of effort in no understanding then of what particularly they're getting or what you know, what role that is. Yeah, or just like, oh, yeah, okay,
exactly
yeah,
right.
It came with my license, you know, or whatever.
Right.
So I think that is important. I don't have an answer, but once you said that to me and you said that, I thought, you know what? I want to go back and take a look at that data now and look at the difference in engagement and intent to vote from states where that is automatic and states potentially where it's not as easy, like Texas.
And actually, that's a very good way to wrap the panel, is that, look, everybody's looking for a silver bullet, right? Everybody's wants to find the one thing that's going to fix everything. The reality is that we need all kinds of layers and treatments, because we have different folks with different situations that need to be approached in different ways. What we do know is that for Latinos, community and family matter. What we know is that for Latinos, their parents, their teachers are important in this situation. And so that's why we're trying to make sure that we incorporate this in the work that we do with parents, and that we're trying to give teachers the tools they have so they can engage students. But the reality is that there's no silver bullet. It's going to take a lot of elbow grease. And I agree that while some folks are looking for automatic registration and all of that, we're going to need to look at it carefully to see what its real impact is. Because I think, and we'll have to document that with some studies working with Sylvia, but I think that conversation that happens between a canvasser and that person, or even online, or the friend, is important, because it gives you context. It tells you what matters. And for folks who may not know about the Supreme Court, I think that our community has gotten a stellar education about the importance of the Supreme Court in the last couple of years with SB 1070, the Show Me Your Papers law, with DACA and DAPA, and with a number of other cases. And if that weren't enough, think about your city council, your mayor, and your state legislature that, beyond the president, have way more impact on your daily life. So please register the app. You never know when you're going to come across someone who is not registered. And the great thing with the app is that if you're in a state like Florida or others that have restrictions on third-party voter registration, you don't have to worry about that, because the person's registering themselves. So download the app and tweet out to your friends, to your family, and use the